I think all great scholarship is a matter of personal passion and to some extent personal self-discovery. If it's only self-discovery, then it's not scholarship. But if it is personal discovery raised to the level of a genuine subject, then it can be significant scholarship. I wrote the book, The Creed, as a member of the Roman Catholic Church who was concerned about the shape of Christian identity. I was convinced that there's a connection between the way we think and the way we act. By writing that, I revealed myself to be a very specific kind of religious person. And it's that which is the subject of my newest book. I began to realize that the way I assumed everybody was religious is not the way that everybody's religious. I belong to a very specific subcategory of religious type people that is common to intellectuals, academics, philosophers, and prophets, namely, concern about moral transformation and the connection between ideas and practices. What I began to investigate in this new book are the three other ways of being religious that are found both in Christianity and in ancient Greco-Roman religion, as well as in Judaism, and I would wager also in Islam and other world religions, although I couldn't examine those here. So to write this new book, I took off the hat of the Christian theologian and put on the hat of the student of religion, because I was doing fundamentally a comparative task. When I look at Greco-Roman religion, I find that the vast majority of people who are religious, now, in every society, there's lots of people who aren't religious. And this was true of the ancient world as well. There were people who were totally profane, as in Satyricon's novel, Petronius's novel Satyricon, the characters are utterly profane. All they're worried about is getting laid, basically. They have no thought about God at all. There are other people who are skeptics about religion in the ancient world. But among those whom we might call religious, namely, people whose lives are primarily organized around experiences and convictions concerning ultimate power. So the term power here is really critical. And the organization of life around the perceptions of where that power is. Among such people, the vast majority belong to what I call type one. That is, religion is access to a higher power in this world. It's accessible through ritual, through festivals, through pilgrimages, through relics, through all kinds of healings, through all kinds of empirical manifestations. And the whole point is to have access to that power for success. Salvation is success. You do better in the world, you have a better network of friends and so forth if you are that type of religious person. That's type one. In Christianity, as in the ancient Greek and Roman world, that type predominates. Most religious people are fundamentally into it for the access to power that it provides them. The second type that I suggested I might belong to, the second type doesn't deny that there's power out there. They're not interested in saying there's no such things as miracles, or people don't get healed, or pilgrimages are not significant. They're simply not interested. Their concern is how the divine power is imminent, not out there, but within moral endeavor. In the Greco-Roman world, these were philosophers like Dio Chrysostom and Epictetus and Seneca. The point was how to transform one's own character and affect the character of others. It's what used to be called athletic Christianity. It's that moral endeavor is the point. So pilgrimages, well, it's interesting if you want to go, but can't you do a pilgrimage within? Can't you work to change your mind and heart and become a better character? Type one, public. political, pious, pragmatic. Type two, much more individualistic, much more demanding, much more inward-looking, the examination of conscience. Type three, you guys are all mistaken. There is no power here. The whole point of religion is get out of here as fast as possible. This is the type I call transcending the world. It's that whole, wow, the body is a horrible mistake. The world is a terrible mistake. Materiality corrupts. Only the soul gets saved. And so the point of life is to get the soul as free of the body as possible. In the Greco-Roman world, these were the mystics. These were the people who sought purification, vegetarians, hunger artists, people who avoided contact with others in order to free the soul. In early Christianity, it was the Gnostics. That's how we should understand second century Christian Gnostics. That's three types. The fourth type took me a long time to find until my friend Mary Jo Weaver at Indiana University said, think bishop. And the fourth type are people who are interested in religious institution. They're the people who put on the festivals, who dress in long garb and walk in procession, who organize pilgrimages, who run the shrines, who serve as the Vestal Virgins or the priests at the altar. They are the people who think that they are the most altruistic because by making the institution provide all these things, they're making the power accessible to others. It is type four, above all, who are concerned with boundaries. What should be good religion, what should be bad religion, and so forth. So these four types I find in Greco-Roman religion, in Judaism of the Hellenistic period, and in Christianity as it develops. I began my interest in Greco-Roman religion has always been there because it is so intrinsically fascinating. But it became particularly interesting as I began to think about the ways in which the conversation about Christianity and so-called paganism or Greco-Roman religion had been so skewed by centuries and centuries of Christian polemic. The language of the New Testament and the language of Christian theology about the religion of the pagans is awful. It's worse than the language that Christians use about Jews. It's all negative. In fact, the religions of pagans are demonic. And that tradition has run through all of Christian history so that Christian missionaries are saving pagan babies from the demons, right? And so there's this tremendous sense that everything out there is in darkness and so forth. And I thought to myself, that can't be true. That can't be true. That language of polemic, just as in the case of Judaism, has a certain identity formative impulse, which we might understand, but it can't be relied upon to be an honest report of what these people were about. So I began to be interested in it from that perspective, and also from the perspective that I'm Roman Catholic. I'm the kind of person that my Protestant colleagues are always accusing of messing up Christianity by making it pagan, right? So you have that classic Reformation interpretation of Christianity as moving from a pure, pristine teaching of Jesus or theology of Paul, and then in the second century becoming corrupted by sacraments, priests, rituals, law, and all of these things, which turn out to be, wow, Catholic. So I was thought maybe this is too simple and also polemical a view of Christian origins. The final nudge to take up this topic was provided by the great historian of religion, Jonathan Z. Smith, from the University of Chicago. And in an earlier book, I talked about religious experience in earliest Christianity, because I thought this was a terribly neglected topic. And
I read a lot of Jonathan Z. Smith, and Jonathan Z. Smith is brilliant at identifying that stream of polemic that he calls pagano-papism. That is the Protestant polemic against Catholic influence in early Christianity, Pope, paganism, right? The two things go together, pagano-papism. But in Jonathan Z. Smith's analysis, once you get rid of that polemic, there's nothing there at all. There isn't any Christianity at all. And I thought, there has to be a better form of analysis than that which destroys the subject matter. And so I began to ask, isn't there a better way of asking about early Christianity? Not in terms of paganism influencing Christianity, as though Christianity was a monolithic, intact reality that was being influenced by something outside it. But rather, how did Judaism and Christianity arise out of very similar Greco-Roman roots? It's not a matter of influence. It's a matter of being in that soil from the very beginning. Because most of the converts to Christianity were Gentiles. So they were bringing these presuppositions in. So what instrument could I use? I borrowed from William James, who analyzed religion in terms of personality types, healthy religion, pathological religion, or sick personality, and the way their religion differed. And I said, we could extend this. The sources actually support four different ways of being religious. So at some level, my study is a study of religious psychology. Its focus is on human temperament, sensibility. How do different people relate differently to the world because of that religious temperament? I think that it's very fair to say that Paul and other early Christian writers were deeply influenced by the Gentile world. This is partly what I'm trying to examine. And that when Paul uses the language of mystery, for example, with reference to what God is doing in this community, he is echoing the language of mysteries that is used in Greco-Roman religion. It is, however, a distortion to say that when Paul spoke about baptism and referred to Christian ritual as a mystery, that he simply imported that understanding wholesale in from the Greco-Roman world. There is both similarity and distinction, otherwise Christianity would not be a new thing that made its way in the world and became the dominant imperial religion over the course of four centuries. But yes, everywhere in the New Testament and in Jewish literature, we find the same religious phenomena as we find in Greco-Roman religion. In Judaism, there are pilgrimages. There is a temple worship. There is prophecy. There is healing. In early Christianity, healing, prophecy, pilgrimage, and so forth. Part of the problem with the former conversation is that it identified Greco-Roman religion with only one thing, namely the mystery religions. And that then became the great nut to crack open. But if we put mystery religions together with prophecy and healing and pilgrimages and magic on a continuum of one way of being religious, that is, the way of immediate access to power, then what we find in the New Testament portrayals of Jesus, for example, as a healer, as healing people, when we see Paul and the Acts of the Apostles talk about signs and wonders that are done through the name of Jesus, we're very much in the ballpark of religiousness type A, the first kind of religious sensibility. In contrast, when Paul and James and the letter to the Hebrews say to their readers, well, that's a good start. Now let's grow up. You know, you need to shape your character. You need to think with the mind of Christ. You need to learn how to advance. Now they're acting like Greco-Roman philosophers. Equally religious, but with a different kind of religiosity. So in the Gospels, notice, Jesus is entirely a God on earth. He suffers, but so do some of the other gods. But he is, above all, a benefactor, somebody who makes power accessible to others, calls the outcast, heals, draws people, right? Creates a people, open, public, access. Jesus is infinitely accessible in the Gospels. But there's very little about examine your conscience, you know, think in a different way, and so forth. That's what we find in Paul and James and Hebrews. They are the first generation Christian philosophers. And those are the only two types we find at the beginning. Only in the second and third century do we see the other types developing. The question about the presence of things like pilgrimage, prophecy, healings, initiation into mysteries and so forth in Christianity as being influenced by Greco-Roman religion, I think, is to put the question a little bit too narrowly. That is, I would prefer to say all of these things are found in early Christianity as it develops as one way of being Christian. That in the second century, for example, we find that way of being Christian magnificently displayed in the apocryphal Acts of the Apostles, in the infancy Gospels, and in martyrologies, you know, this sense of being in contact with power. But the second way of being religious is also found in Christianity. We begin to see the development of Christian philosophers, people who are interested in virtue and in condemning vice. It's not about power out there. It's about the power within. Then we have the third type, namely Gnostics, those people out in the Egyptian desert who said, let's get out of here. The whole point of being religious is to find mystical ascent in this life as a preparation for freeing the soul from its physical entrapment in the present. So, among some Christian groups, to be Christian, to be baptized, meant that you had to be a virgin. Severe fasting, you know, hunger artistry was encouraged. Severe physical mortification, putting the body to death. Do we find this among the philosopher types? No. They're interested in living in the world and trying to figure out how to be a good citizen. Right? Do we find this among the pilgrimage types? No, they're interested in tourism. So in the second and third century, we find those three types of Greco-Roman religiosity in Christianity. And we find the first glimmerings of type four, where you begin to see all of a sudden Christian bishops, superintendents is a better translation of episcopos, Christian bishops are starting to be referred to as priests. And the prayers that they offer are starting to be called sacrifices. And there seems to be a greater distinction between the priestly class and the lay class. And what we find here is very much type four in Greco-Roman religion. So notice that in our early church orders, we have all of these stages of initiation. You're baptized, yes, and you're confirmed, yes. Everybody gets that. But if you want to climb higher in this new thing, you have to be a doorkeeper, an exorcist, a lector, an acolyte, a thurifer, a subdeacon, a deacon, and then a priest. And then if you're really good, you get to be a bishop. Okay? So you have all these stages of initiation, which are advancement in societal ranks. It's Christianity as a cursus honorum, as a civic bureaucratic career. So it's not by accident that we find in the fourth century, many of our bishops are Roman senators, because you have the same, you have the equivalent political advancement as you do in the secular world. And the great Christian theologians of the fourth and fifth centuries were all trained rhetoricians. They were trained in Greco-Roman rhetoric. They had the attitudes of the senatorial class. They tended to be elitist, right? And so their view of Christianity was quite distinct from that of hoi polloi, of the people on the street. It was the theologians, the philosophers who were interested. Let me see, is it homoiousion or homoousion? Is the divine word equal with God or kind of equal with God? Those kinds of subtle distinctions and the thought that they matter only appeals to type two, people who become academics, people who spend too much time with books. Ordinary people in the street, in Christianity, as in paganism, were much more interested in, is the Blessed Virgin appearing in Medjugorje or isn't she? You know, if my family goes to Medjugorje to visit the Blessed Virgin, is my family going to be healed? And if you were a Catholic in the 1990s, this was exactly what was happening in many parishes. People were taking trips to Yugoslavia, to making pilgrimage as they did to Fatima and to Lourdes, just as the poor Aelius Aristides in the second century made pilgrimages to the healing shrines of Asclepius in order to find healing or salvation. So in my parish in Bloomington, Indiana, half the people were off to Medjugorje. And people like me teaching at Indiana University said, ho-hum, it's not going to make any difference. The reality is here. It's not going to make you a better person. You can do that right here. You don't have to travel to become better. Now, remarkably, I found in a letter of Gregory of Nyssa the exact same attitude. He's writing to nuns who went to the Holy Land in the 4th century in order to see, ooh, the birthplace of Jesus, ooh, the place where he was crucified, ooh, a piece of the Holy Cross, right? Oh my God, we're so much better Christians now because we actually walked where Jesus walked. Okay. And Nyssa says, fundamentally, it's boring. He doesn't find that terribly interesting. He says, you're not a better Christian because you walked in those places. You're a better Christian if in your mind and your heart you act like Jesus acted. So what we have here is a difference in temperament. The breakthrough for me, analytic breakthrough, was to really think as a student of religion rather than as a theologian. Theologians tend to think in Christian categories. Students of religion have a more neutral framework with which to look at phenomena. And so if we look at religion as a way of life organized around convictions and experiences concerning ultimate power, then phenomenologically, we can begin to identify things as having a religious character, even if they're not called religion. So in the year 2009 in the Deep South, SEC football has a religious character, even though it is not called religion. People go in tens and hundreds of thousands in order to experience the rush. They devote their daily lives to checking the scores, to following the careers of coaches, to adulation of athletes. All of this has a quasi-religious character. Political movements, the Obama campaign, everybody commented that it has a kind of a messianic character, and quite right. This is the phenomenology of religious behavior. So once you begin to look at religion that way, you begin to see things that you didn't beforehand. And for me, the breakthrough was seeing Greco-Roman philosophy as a way of being religious. So then I had what everybody knows is religious, namely cultic things and participation things and pilgrimages and prophecies and healings and all that stuff. But quietly, on the side of that, are these people who are totally dedicating themselves. I mean, they lived in communities. Many of them shared their possessions. They had rituals of initiation. So in the Pythagorean school, you spent years as a novice, and then you were introduced to the higher orders. Jeepers, that's just like the mysteries. And if you read the Jewish philosopher Philo of Alexandria, he said, I was initiated into the mysteries of Moses. Well, what does he mean? means that he was initiated into the study of the law, and then he had a second higher initiation into the prophet Jeremiah. So this, the study and the work of philosophy could be seen as religious behavior. Then, of course, you have the people who want to get out of here, the Orphic tradition in Greco-Roman teaching, the Dionysiac tradition. This is which says this is all a terrible mistake. Life is tragic, right? It begins badly and it never gets better. So the only thing that's rescuable is the part of you that's divine, namely the soul. So it's what many people today would call spirituality. That's type three, right? Everywhere today, people will say, I'm not religious, but I'm spiritual. That's type three. It's the cultivation of the inner self, the purification of the self. I won't eat lentils. That's what Pythagoras said. I won't eat meat. Well, it's the contemporary equivalent. Why don't you want to eat beans? Because it pollutes the soul. Why don't you want to eat meat? Because it pollutes the soul. Right? And so being a vegan purifies you for a better way of life. And then you've always had bishops and academic deans and so forth. So they're always around because people love to organize. So this more neutral lens of ways of being religious really represented a breakthrough for me. Now, I think it has tremendous pertinence for looking at religion today. This analysis, both within Christianity and in terms of the relationship of Christianity to other world religions. And in many respects, this is the way that I frame the book, that the issue of how Christianity relates to other world religions is more pressing and difficult today than ever, because world religions are not far away. They're in our kids' playground. Pluralism is not, none of us live in villages anymore. We all have to deal with a pluralistic world. So if we look at our Bibles and say, what does the Bible say about people of other faiths? Well, it's not good on Jews, and it's worse on people who aren't Jews, right? So how can we think better about this? Okay, number one, within Christianity, it's helpful to realize that we're separated and distinguished much more by temperament than we are by doctrine and morals. For me, I ask myself the question, who do I agree theologically more with, Jimmy Swaggart or Bishop John Spong, the famous liberal bishop of Newark, New Jersey? Doctrinally, I would have to say Jimmy Swaggart. Do I believe in the resurrection? Yay. Do I believe in healing? Yes. Do I believe in X and Y? Yes. Whereas Bishop Spong doesn't, on the record. But then why would I rather have lunch with Bishop Spong than Jimmy Swaggart? And it's because Bishop Spong is my type of Christian. We're like academics. We think alike. We have the same values. Religion's about social change. It's about individual change. Whereas Jimmy Swaggart is type A. It's all about the power, right? It's all about being slain in the spirit, about speaking in tongues, about the size of the crowd, about the size of the revenues as well. So I think it's very, very helpful for us to recognize most bishops are deeply suspicious of theologians. They think too much. They are very suspicious also of popular religion. We better get it credentialed and check it out, right? And mystics they don't have much use for because they're just, out of this world, quite literally. On the other side, mystics think bishops are not religious at all. Type two theologians think that bishops are not really religious, but just in it for the power. And type A religious people scarcely advert to bishops at all. So there are real ways in which we're different within Christianity. And I think it sort of helps. Actually, it's a way of looking at the university as well. Most scholars don't think of deans as being real scholars. They're administrators. Deans think of themselves as enabling scholarship. Teachers are type 2, deans are type 4. And people tend to drift toward one or the other. And both deans and professors have no use for type A. You know, this is a place where we study and organize things, right? Real religion is what we find in books. Type A people say real religion isn't what you find in books, it's what you find in power. Okay. All right, so that's within Christianity. I think our differences are as much temperamental as they are doctrinal. Presbyterians don't understand Pentecostals. Pentecostals don't understand Presbyterians. Calvinists don't understand Roman Catholics. Roman Catholics don't understand Calvinists. It's not that they don't understand the ideas. They don't understand how you could be religious that way. It's not their taste. With regard to world religions, I think the same thing applies. Namely, it's really important for Christians to recognize we're not so very different from other people. That our ways of being religious are probably also their ways of being religious. And that the ways that we have tended to define ourselves in terms of our ideas and our convictions and our organization may not be most important. Within Christianity, there is all this ferment of and variety and diversity of religious expression. The more we are in touch with that, the better able we are to converse with and learn from peoples of other religions. It's like going to a rock concert. It's like, you know, that or going to hear somebody speak. What do you get from a lecturer that you don't get in the book? Presence, power, excitement, participation, right? This is why rock stars are always confused when they introduce new songs on tour and people cry out for the old regulars. They want to experience the rush, the power, right? So when Bill Clinton came to campus, when Barack Obama comes to town or the Dalai Lama comes to campus, people who need to be there are demonstrating religiousness type A. Because religiousness type A is participation in power. And the Dalai Lama radiates presence and power. Does this mean that people are going to become Tibetan Buddhists? No. Nobody's interested in the Theravada. They're interested in the sand artistry and the mandala and the esoteric character, the exotica of the Dalai Lama. But most of all, it's an event. It's a happening. And whenever people think in terms of happening rather than in terms of how can I be a better person today, how can I be a better teacher, how can I be a better whatever, then they're demonstrating religiousness A. So that's what's going on with the Dalai Lama. Oh, I'm sure. But if they chatted with the Dalai Lama, they didn't chat with him about theology. The Dalai Lama is not a theologian. He exemplifies. In his subjectivity, the Dalai Lama exhibits type 3. That is the type of internal purification through Theravada Buddhism, right? The annihilation of the self, and so forth and so on. Phenomenologically, he is an instrument of type A. He's a rock star. When he comes to town, everything shifts, right? So when the president comes to any town or city in this country, it's power. Power displaces. So motorcades, streets are blocked, schedules are changed, right? And everything organizes around the perception of power. Maybe not ultimate power, but pretty close. Why do you want to crash a White House dinner party? Access to power. What does access power give you? Higher status in the reality TV game. So it's, you know, this is how, isn't this fun? You know, religious studies is so fascinating because, you know, being religious is such a fundamental way of being human. And if we can get the right categories of how to analyze religious behavior, we have one of the great instruments for understanding human behavior that's not simply reducible to economic predictors. Because religious behavior manifests itself quite apart from, I think, social determinism. So you find highly educated people getting giddy with the thought of being in the presence of a powerful religious figure. Fascinating aspect of my analysis is that if we look at Judaism in the period between Alexander the Great and the end of the second century, so roughly late third century BCE and late second century CE, we find it totally engaged with Greco-Roman culture. It's more Jews lived outside Palestine than within. Greek was spoken within Palestine and outside Palestine. The Bible had been translated into Greek 250 years before the time of Jesus. For people in Jews in Alexandria, which was one of the largest populations of Jews in the ancient world, they didn't know Hebrew. Their Bible was in Greek. They spoke Greek. They read Greek. They wrote in Greek. An entire literature, Jewish literature, is based on that Greek translation of the Bible. So it was Philo who talked about being initiated into the mysteries of Moses, for example. We even have a composition called Pseudo-Orpheus, which pictures Abraham and Moses as the teacher of Orpheus, right? And as ascending to the divine presence, very much within the framework of Greco-Roman world. Christianity grew up in conversation with this form of Judaism above all. In other words, a Judaism that was already intensely Hellenized. Okay? So that was a very active conversation. As Christianity grew demographically more and more Gentile and grew larger and larger, it entered more fully, became more invested in all of the social and political forms of the Greco-Roman world. So that when Constantine and his successors in the 4th century first legitimized Christianity and then made it the imperial religion, they actually brought Christianity into its full flowering. It was from the beginning a Gentile religion, and now it displayed all four aspects of Gentile religiosity in full bloom. It was only when the Roman Empire collapsed and monasticism became the vehicle of Christianity's survival, that those Greco-Roman forms became modified. Okay. The history of Judaism was just the opposite. Christianity was married to Gentile religion and stayed married as long as there was Gentile religion. Judaism, in contrast, had a fairly lengthy dalliance. After the destruction of the temple in the year 70, after the complete collapse of messianic hopes with the Bar Kokhba revolt around the year 135, and the bulldozing of Jerusalem and the renaming of it as Aelia Capitolina, it was pretty clear that the conversation with the Greco-Roman world was not going well for Jews, especially since the form of Judaism that was most succeeding in the Greco-Roman world was this apostate form called Christianity. Now, Judaism had an option. Christianity had no option but to keep growing the way that it grew because its roots in Judaism were extraordinarily shallow. Within a generation, most of its adherents were Gentile. Its language was Greek, right? And it grew into the rhetorical and social forms of the Gentile world. Judaism had a longer history rooted in Hebrew, in Aramaic. What happens then in the late second century, in the beginning of the third century? The classic composition called the Mishnah, which is the compilation of the law under Judah Hanasi, Judah the Prince, around the year 200, was written in classical Hebrew, not Greek. All the commentary on that was written in Aramaic, the language of the Eastern diaspora. The language of Judaism is Hebrew and Aramaic from that time forward. These are not Gentile languages. These are Jewish languages. Here's the proof of the pudding. In the middle of the second century, three Jews produced translations of the Bible into Greek, Aquila, Symmachus, and Theodotion, to rival that Greek version used by the Christians, called the Septuagint. In other words, they tried to displace Christian claims by providing their own more Jewish translation of the Greek. But after the year 200, we have no other composition, Jewish composition, written in Greek. And the next translation of the Bible into the vernacular that takes place in the 10th century is into Arabic, the new conversation partner, Islam. So Judaism turned its back on. Does this mean that those four ways of being religious are not found in Judaism? I think they are, but in highly modified ways, which leads me to suspect that my typology is not restricted to Greco-Roman religion and Christianity, but may actually be a broader typology applicable to how people are religious. No, my next books are on all completely different subjects. In my writing, I distinguish between jobs of work and works of love. And jobs of work are things that people ask me to do or whatever. And works of love are working out ideas that intrigue me. And the next work of love for me is after a book I'm now writing, but the next work of love will be called The Revelatory Body, which will talk about the way in which the body is the vehicle of revelation or the medium of revelation, and do again a phenomenological reading of the human body and its capacity to reveal God or not reveal God. So that'll be another labor of love. I think that the writings of the New Testament and this sort of study should deeply chasten reflection on Christian mission. Christian mission has always positioned itself as a rescue operation, that people were in desperate straits, were indeed under the influence of demons, and that we needed to, baptize them in the dozens and thousands in order to rescue them. More and more over the last centuries, we've recognized the deep ambiguity of that already, the way in which Christian mission has also been a part of colonialism, a part of a hegemonic project to displace other cultures. But I think this study also suggests that it is impossible to read the reflections of Marcus Aurelius or of Epictetus and not recognize a very powerful, profound, authentic mode of religious expression. It is impossible to read the sacred tales of Aelius Aristides, that magnificent rhetorician who spent his life seeking physical healing from the god Asclepius, but was willing to accept his continuing suffering because the gods sustained him in his career as a rhetorician, and he attributed all of his success to the god. It is impossible to read this literature and not to recognize that it is the furthest thing possible from the demonic. It is indeed a form of religious expression from which we can learn much. And at the very least, we need to respect. So respect for the other, and then eventually learning from the other, I think are the stages that Christians need to be at, both with regard to Judaism and to other world religions.